This video is about control unit and instruction code. Continuing to build our instruction set, we see the jump instructions and in particular the unconditional jump instruction. Jump instructions are used for changing the flow of execution of instruction in the processor. If we won't jump to any instruction in between the code, then this can be achieved by these instructions. We have two kinds of jump instructions, conditional jumps and unconditional jumps. Conditional jumps are used to implement any conditional statement like if else or to implement the loop logic. Unconditional jumps are used to implement the logic that don't require any condition, and they are also used in if else and also in loops. It can be used to jump out of the loop, and it is also used in procedure to break the flow of the program. Let's see an example of both conditional and unconditional jumps. We use the if-then-else statement. This piece of program says that if A is less than 7, CPU executes instruction X and Y. Else, if A is larger or equal 7, CPU executes instruction Z. This is a typical high-level piece of program, but let's see how we can translate it in our low-level language. The language we have created to represent code CPU operations. Here, you can see the translation. On the right, we put the addresses, and on the left, the code. You see, we put the number 7 in R0. With the data instruction, and we imagine of having already put the variable A in R1. Then we compare R1 and R0, or A and 7, and we use a conditional jump instruction. The jump instruction jumps if the result of the comparison is equal or larger, so if R1 is equal or larger than 7. It jumps to address X, where we can find the instruction Z. In this way, we perform the else statement. But if R1 is less than R0, or A is less than 7, the condition is not met, and we perform the instruction X and Y. After instruction Y, we need an unconditional jump instruction, because we have to jump the instruction Z, which doesn't have to be executed if A is less than 7. So we jump to address Y, next to instruction Z. As we have learned in previous videos, we can write the corresponding machine language. Here you can see the data instruction, which takes 2 bytes, one for the instruction and the other for the data. Here there is a compare, and here the conditional jump, which takes 2 bytes also, as the unconditional jump here used to jump the instruction Z. The CPU we are talking about is the Scott's CPU from the book But How Do It Know? By J. Clare Scott. An instruction code is a group of bits that instruct the computer to perform a specific operation. An instruction can be divided in 2 parts. The first part is called opcode and the second one address code, because generally define the addresses in which you can find operands or data. In the Scott CPU, we select one of our 4 registers. In order to control the 4 register, we have to act in the enable input to put the byte on the bus and in the set input to acquire the byte from the bus. As you can see, we have 4 bits opcode, in which you can have a maximum of 16 different combinations or kind of instructions. In Scott's CPU case, we have 15 different kind of instructions. We already saw the 8 ALU instructions, and now we add the NOT ALU instruction to our set. We see here an example of unconditional jump. This jump instruction is used to jump to an address contained in R2, or more generally, jump to the address in RB. Remember, we have already built some important components of Scott's CPU, the RAM memory, the ALU, and we are building the control unit. At the heart of the control unit, there is the stepper, which gives the right sequence to all the operations. As we saw in previous video, we have 6 steps, In first three steps, we put on the bus the instruction address, increment it by one, and fetch the instruction in the instruction register. In the second three steps, steps 4, 5, and 6, we execute the instruction. So, this is a simulation of the jump instruction. As we said in previous video, we use the first three steps to fetch and increment the instruction address register and steps 4, 5, and 6 to execute the instructions. We remember the memory is partly dedicated to the program and partly to the data. First, we put on the bus the instruction address register content and from there to the memory address register. So now we have the RAM address of our instruction selected. Simultaneously, being the instruction address on the bus, we activate bus 1 and being opcode to 000 by default, we perform another operation, incrementing by 1 the address of the instruction and putting the result in the accumulator register. As we said, in MAR there is the instruction address and we start to fetch the instruction in the IR or instruction register, where we decode it. In our case, it states to jump to the address contained in R2. The last part of the first three steps is the moving of the next instruction address from accumulator to IAR. In this way, we memorize the next instruction address in IAR. Once the instruction is decoded, we start the execute part in steps 4, 5, and 6. We have first to put the address in R2 on the bus, and then we load it on IAR. In this way, in IAR, there is the address in R2, and in the next instruction cycle, we'll execute the instruction in that address, and not the instruction next to the jump instruction. In other words, we have jumped to another part of the code. We didn't meet any condition, so this is an unconditional jump. Now we see how to execute the jump instruction in step 4. Here you see the logic circuit we need to execute this kind of jump instruction. First, being the bit 7 of instruction register to 0, we enable all the AND gates, thus enabling the NOT ALU instruction section. When the bit 4, 5, and 6 are 011, we have the opcode for the jump instruction and the fourth output of the decoder 328 is ON, thus putting in ON the fourth AND gate of the decoder. When step 4 arrives, we put in ON the output of the AND 1, thus giving an enable pulse in reg B, putting the register content on the bus and a set pulse to register IAR acquiring the content from the bus. In this moment, instruction address register has acquired the address in RB, R2 in our case. So in the next instruction cycle, we will execute the instruction in that address and not the one next to the jump instruction. In other words, we have jumped to another part of the code. We didn't meet any condition, so it is an unconditional jump. Now we see another jump instruction. This time we always jump unconditionally, but the address is provided in the next byte. So the instruction states to jump, but we don't provide any indication about registers, because we provide the address in the next byte. Now we see how to execute this jump instruction called JMP in steps 4 and 5. Here you see the logic circuit we need to execute this kind of jump. Bit 7 of instruction register is 0 and we enable all the AND gate, thus enabling the NOT ALU instruction section. When the bits 4, 5 and 6 of the instruction registers are 100, we have the opcode of the JMP instruction and the fifth output of the decoder 328 is ON, thus putting in ON the fifth AND gate of the decoder. When step 4 arrives, we put the output of the AND 2 in ON, thus giving an enable pulse in IAR, putting the register content on the bus, and a set pulse to register MAR, acquiring the content from the bus. In this moment, memory address register has acquired the byte next to the jump instruction, so the address in which we want to jump. When step 5 arrives, the output of AND 3 is on, giving an enable pulse to RAM, which puts the content on the bus, and a set pulse to IAR to acquire the data from the bus. As you can see, we moved the address in which we want to jump on the IAR register. In this way, in the next instruction cycle, we start from that address to fetch the code. Thank you for watching. Please leave me a comment and let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put the thumb up, click the notification bell, and subscribe to my channel.